Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. Oh, Corinth. I can only imagine the passion and emotion that the Apostle Paul, that great missionary of the faith, must have had for the people, and specifically Christians, living in Corinth. That Greek city, that commercial city that had everything. For it was in Corinth that Paul had spent a year and a half, being able to get to know the people there, being able to raise them up in the faith and knowledge of everything that God had done for them. And it was in Corinth that he found an insane amount of gifts that these people had. Gifts that they could use to serve each other and to serve the church at large. But he also saw the sinful nature at work. And using those very same gifts to tear down instead of to build up. Using those very same gifts selfishly instead of selflessly. Perhaps for this reason that we have two letters that Paul wrote that are actually recorded for us in the New Testament, 1 and 2 Corinthians. We actually have evidence that he wrote at least one more as well. And throughout these letters, Paul shows his love, his care, his compassion for the people in Corinth. So many times, Paul had to, like a good parent, like any good pastor, discipline his people. He had to correct them and say, "What you are doing is wrong, and you should stop doing it." But he also had moments and times when he could encourage the people as well. And it's in this section of 2 Corinthians where we see Paul giving some encouragement. And it had to do with an offering that the Corinthians had planned to give. Now, like many of the Christian congregations that Paul had started that were scattered throughout the Mediterranean, they had heard about the plight of their brothers and sisters in Christ in Jerusalem. They were dealing with a famine where it was a struggle for them to make ends meet. They couldn't find enough food to put on their tables, and the Corinthians, among others, decided quite well that they should take up a collection to be able to help provide for their brothers and sisters in Jerusalem. So they began this work, a good work, a generous work. But what started with such fervor began to falter and was in danger of failing completely. And that's why Paul had to encourage them. He had to re-encourage them, not only reminding them of the importance of the gift, but also why we give in general. And it's these verses from 2 Corinthians that provide some of the scriptural foundation for our reason for giving. Whether it be our regular offerings or our serving our neighbor in other ways. It's what our whole service today has been about as we continue to examine this idea of meaningful ministry, meaningful service to others, especially how it relates to the blessings we've been given. There's two things I want you to be able to take away from today. The first is that everything we have, everything we own, everything we possess comes from God. And the second is just as important as why God gives all that to us. It's not for us to use on our own selves, but so that we might be generous to others. In short, we have been enriched to be generous. Now, I know when we start talking about money in church, there will be those comments that come out of the woodwork saying, "All the church cares about is my money." Kind of that idea of keep your hands off my money. But I think a comment like that betrays a few different things. First of all, it betrays a love of money that really shouldn't be there. As if I love my money so much, so the church better not love it as well. But then also, it has a misunderstanding of where our money comes from. Maybe in your preparation for worship, you opened up your worship folder, and on the inside cover, you saw that summary of where the worship was going. How God meets our needs so we can meet the needs of others. And right there at the very beginning, we have a quote from Psalm 24, where King David says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it." Everything in the world, everything we own is God's. our home and our possessions, our vehicle and what's in our trunk, what's in our bank account and the $28 in our wallet itself and the pocket that we place our wallet in. All of that is from God. It's given to us by God to use. We have been enriched beyond measure, sometimes even more than we realize. It came to light for me a few weeks ago when we were on vacation, and one of the stops that we made, one of the places we visited, was the summer seaside cottage of the Vanderbilts that they had built 120 years ago. And it was extravagant beyond measure, but there were some things in there that we take for granted as basic necessities. One example is the mattress that you sleep on, whether it's a Tempur-Pedic or whether it's just a plain old mattress, is probably a lot better than the mattress that the Vanderbilts would have slept on 120 years ago. And yet it's not just when it comes to your mattresses that you have been blessed and enriched. It's been so many other things as well. See what Paul writes in the very beginning of our reading today. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need. Very rarely will we have everything that we want, but God isn't talking about what we want. He's talking about what we need. And God says He will provide everything that we need. Now, maybe He's not going to do it in the same way that He did in each of our other readings for today. Maybe not in the same way that He did for the Israelites as He provided quail in the evening and manna in the morning while they wandered in the desert. Maybe He's not going to do it in the same way that Jesus did it for the crowd of 5,000 as He miraculously broke five loaves of bread and two fish and fed 5,000. But He can and does provide for all of our needs. Many in very natural ways, whether it be through the skills that we've learned or the jobs that we possess, but even in some other ways as well, through the generosity of others. When they take us out for a meal or offer to watch our kids for babysitting. Or even just the fact that we are born at this time and this place. We have been blessed abundantly. We have been enriched beyond measure. And that's not even including our greatest blessing. The greatest way that God has enriched us. And that's through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Because of what Jesus has done, we are heirs of heaven, of heavenly riches, of the mansions of heaven. We have that hope, that sure hope that is beyond anything that this world could possibly offer. Yes, we have been enriched tremendously. And everything we have belongs to God and has been given to us by God to manage. That's the first thing we need to understand. Because it's only after we understand that, that everything we have comes from God, that we can understand why God gives us everything we have. And it's not just to do whatever we want with. It's so that we might be generous to others. We have been enriched to be generous. Now, the most common way that people think about this is completely opposite to what God's truth says. They look at their possessions, they look at their wealth, their house, their boat, all their stuff as things that they have earned, that they deserve, that they can do whatever they want with, and God better not tell me what I should do with my money. Sometimes even Christians can start to fall into this trap, that even though we can admit that everything comes from God and even the skills we have to create that wealth, sometimes we have an unhealthy attachment to it, our stuff, so much so that we don't want God to take any part of it. And yet that's not how God talks. We have been enriched not for our own benefit and our own blessing, but we have been enriched to be generous to others. And we see that in our final verse from today. Paul writes, "You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion." So important, I want to repeat that for you again. you will be enriched in every way, that you can be generous on every occasion. The so that is key. The reason God enriches us is not for our own benefit. It's not for our own pleasure or enjoyment. It's not for us to do whatever we want with those riches. He does it so that we can be generous. Kind of reminds me of a TED Talk that I heard a portion of recently. The speaker started out by saying the purpose of a car is not to put gas in it. The purpose of a car is to get you from point A to point B. Yes, you have to put gas in it to do that, but that's not the reason you buy the car. So also the purpose of a company, the speaker went on to say, is not to make money. Yes, companies will make money, but the purpose of a company is to provide a goods or a service to someone that makes their life a little bit better. That's the purpose of companies. So apply that TED Talk truth to the spiritual truth that we're looking at today. The purpose of our wealth, the purpose of our riches, the purpose of all of our stuff is not to enjoy it simply for ourselves. The purpose is so that we can be generous to others. And don't get me wrong, that's not to say that we can't enjoy our wealth. That's not to say that we can't go on a vacation or we can't go out to eat or anything like that. But if that's the only thing that we're doing with our wealth, that would be the same thing as buying a car just so you can put gas in it. Not accomplishing its purpose. So we have been given this amazing opportunity by God. We have been so tremendously enriched by God so that we can be generous to others. Yes, one of the ways we can do that is through our regular and faithful, cheerful gifts that we give to Grace week after week. Another way is through the special gifts that we take up collections for, like, for instance, the lights that seem to be going out every once in a while here. Or even the paying down the mortgage with our capital campaign. But I also don't want you to simply be generous here at Grace. I want you to be generous outside of the walls of Grace as well. In our community. The people that you rub shoulders with. Maybe it's through buying someone a cup of coffee or taking a coworker or a friend out to lunch. Maybe it's not even with the material gifts you've been given. Maybe it's through the time that you spend helping a neighbor put on a deck, or just the quality time you spend with someone who is lonely and just needs someone to talk to. Perhaps it's the skills you have been able to develop that you are able to offer in complimentary service to your neighbor, or friend, or family member, whatever it might be. God has enriched us to be generous to others. And while it is a blessing in and of itself, as we use our time, talent, and treasures in blessing to others, we mustn't forget the most amazing way God has blessed us, that spiritual blessing, how God has enriched us, that we might be able to share that great blessing of heaven with others, and the hope that we have that because of Jesus' life, his death, and his resurrection, the stain of sin is gone, the sting of death is gone, the threat of hell is gone, that we have hope and that we have peace of heaven. How can we not but share this with others who I dare say might be a little bit more willing to listen when they see how generous we have been with our other blessings from God? That's really everything that we aim to do here at Grace Lutheran, whether it be for the church or in the school, to not only remind you of all the wonderful blessings you have been given from God, but to help equip you to use those blessings in service to his people and in service to God. Now, a pastor, I know, has a good way of summarizing everything we've been talking about today. He says it this way: money is a tool God gives us to bless others. And this pastor put that saying into practice, whether it was buying a cup of coffee for someone or taking someone out to lunch or how many other ways, using his money as a tool to bless others. May we try and use that too, because we can't take our wealth with us when we leave So why not use it for the purpose that God has given? And in doing so, we have the opportunity to share the greatest blessing that we have been given, the extravagance of heaven. So may we remember how money can be used as a tool to bless others. May we always remember that we have been enriched, not for the benefit of ourselves, but that we have been enriched to be generous to others. Amen. Now may he who began a good work in you carry it out to completion on the day of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.